Hey guys, and welcome back to my Let's Play of Sonic the Hedgehog 2006 for the PlayStation 3. So in the last episode, we began Shadow's very hard stages with White Acropolis, Kingdom Valley, and Crisis City. And those stages were long. They were really long. If you thought White Acropolis was going to take a while, well then you get to Kingdom Valley and you realize these stages just never end. Crisis City, also pretty long. A bit longer than it should have been, really, due to the fact that, you know, nothing wanted to work. The game was decided it wanted to become just as broken as the city itself. And, well, from this point onwards, stages should be a little bit shorter, not by much. Flame Course will take just as long, but after this, the stages start to become relatively shorter until Dusty Desert. Dusty Desert is still going to be a long one. That much I can say, but after this, the stages should be quite short for a while. Because Radical Train and Aquatic Base are actually quite short stages. I know I said before that the Aquatic Base is one of Shadow's shorter stages, and it still ended up going on for quite some time. But I can assure you that Very Hard Mode really isn't that very long of a stage at all for Aquatic Base. And really, neither is Radical Train. And that one is probably a bit longer than the regular version, but for the most part, it's still quite a short stage. And Wave Ocean is a pretty short stage as well. So this is how they realized halfway through, you know, we're making these stages a lot longer and more difficult than they really should be. Perhaps it's a bit too extreme. So you know what? Let's be kind and give them a few slightly shorter stages. However, so that they know we're not just going soft on them, let's make the very last stage a super one. Because sadly, I can't say the same is going to apply to Dusty Deserts. That is a long one. That's probably the longest one. But for now, these stages really aren't going to be... The stages aren't going to take too long. And have I missed one of those light cores, or has one of them just turned off? There's a little bit of a puzzle here. You need to activate all of these light things. And yeah, I did miss one. You need to activate all of these lights, and that will make the case open. Has that worked? Now then, this one's turned off now. Yeah. Alright, fine. They've disappeared. Does that mean it's open? Okay, yeah. You need to activate all of the lights in order to get the case to open. It's kind of a neat little gimmick you have to do there. In order to get that last key, which will deactivate the lasers, which doesn't really matter. In fact, I'm curious now. Do you have to collect those keys? Because I clearly, the lasers were still there and I never reached it. That has made me admittedly curious now. Flame Core, like Crisis City, we are still fighting Eggman's robots in a future level. In fact, I'm beginning to get rather curious now as to whether or not we actually fight Solaris monsters at all. How are you not hitting him, Omega? Thank you. It is making me wonder. Are we ever going to fight Solaris monsters? Because I know we don't fight them in Dusty Desert. That just leaves Wave Ocean. That's the only one I can't remember. Because I have completed Wave Oceans before, but that was a while ago. So I'm struggling to remember now, do we actually fight Solaris monsters there, or is this actually going to be a no Solaris monster run? What is it with these levels and having exits that I had no idea how you're supposed to get to them? I've activated that light, that's not doing anything, there's nothing here. Or do I need to be somewhere very specific again where they're suddenly going to jump at me? What was that? Something appeared over there. That's just fabulous design. If you fall down, you can't get back up. Okay, you make the enemies appear over here then. Of course I die, but that was and look at that! He just appears right there. Now that is cheap design. Because if you don't notice those robots appear, which I'm pretty sure they didn't until I was over there, then that's bad design, because there's no way of getting back up there without touching the lava. I'm ringless again now. See, these stages are very hard because they're cheap a lot of the time. Not all of them, but most of them. Once again, Omega's going to decide he doesn't want to shoot it. And, you know, that's just bad. That they couldn't come up with any competent difficulty. We have to prove that it's very hard by making it cheap. Thankfully, this guy leaves a nice circle of rings. And I do like how that rock just launches Omega right into the wall. Thankfully, he doesn't take any damage. But the enemies aren't here. But you have to go down there in order to get them to appear? Or they just have a really big delay? See, where were all of these guys before? There's like real... There's some sort of issue with the enemies not loading in. It's either that or I have to stand in a very specific spot for a certain amount of time. I don't recall this being the big cameos in Secret Rings. So I don't know why these enemies aren't appearing. Much like at the issue that I had in Kingdom Valley. So I don't know where all of these enemies are going. Why does that need a spring? You can just hover over there. Yeah, just hold down the button and you can use your, just hold down the button and fire the pea shooter like that at these guys, because for some reason Omega doesn't want to attack them. Those legs just left behind. Again, was it possible to change characters there? Because that's really what it's looking like. I mean, maybe there's some sort of programming that stops that from happening. But I really, this being Sonic 06, I really wouldn't be surprised if there wasn't. But you may have noticed that we are actually travelling through the stage backwards. That we even went up that... whatever you call it, that bit with all the geezers and everything, where Shadow would normally go... Rah! Or "ah," as the spelling would tell us. Oh, I was wondering what happened there. I'm not sure if that's how they intended you on completing the stage, but there you go, a shortcut. Why is all that level design there if you can simply just jump down and reach it? Surely for the very hard mode, what you should do is just put that there as the only thing. You need to get that right. Because you have a homing attack. Why give you all that bit of level design down there and just allow you to skip it like that? Come on, meteors! No kidding, I really don't want the meteors hitting here. Yeah, at least this stage actually gives you the sensation that you are going through it backwards. And unlike Sonic, you are actually properly going through the stage backwards. Because of course with Sonic's very hard mode of Flame Core, you went through the two sections backwards, but you still went through each one forwards. So you start at the beginning of the cavern section, and you'll make your way to the end of the cavern section, where you would then hit a portal that took you to the beginning of the first part, where you would then make your way to the end of the first part. So you exit the volcano, and then you go back to the volcano. For Shadow, you are at the very least, you start off at the very end of the stage, where it then takes you through that, and it will launch you out of the volcano, and then you continue to make your way through the level backwards. So you go out of the volcano and you continue to go away from the volcano. I don't know about you guys, but that makes a lot more sense compared to Sonic's version of very hard mode Flame Core. where he makes some very confusing decisions. I do still wonder why we're fighting Eggman's robots. Why didn't they decide? Why are there so few Solaris monsters in very hard mode? I mean, they're still in some stages. They're in most of Silver's ones. Sonic's versions of Crisis City and Flame Core were the only stages in his story where you fought Solaris monsters. They're still there in his version of the stage. Most of Silver's stages are still fighting. I think Crisis City is the only one where you don't. Because you still fight them in Flame Core. And I'm pretty sure you still fight them in Aquatic Base. Yeah, of course you do. You still fight them in Aquatic Base. So, I don't know why things are, why you never fight them for Shadow, when you fought them in so many of his levels before. It's kind of strange. Then again, I find these enemies to be more annoying. Now, back when I first played the game, and I back when I first played the game and I 100%ed it without the DLC, I really thought the Solaris monsters were some of the worst enemies in the franchise. Because of how cheap they were, and it was largely because of those Ibis biters and stalkers just leaping out of the ground with no given warning. Now, I won't deny that that is cheap, because I've said it many times. However, I definitely now think that they are the better enemies. Maybe not in design, maybe not even in concept, but I still think they're better than these guys. For one thing, there's a much better variety of them. Aesthetically, yeah, there's more Eggman's robots. But in terms of actual attacks, they have more variety with what they can do. Yeah, a lot of them are fire rocks. They're just fire rocks that vary in size. You have the Iblis takers are firing the small ones. Then you have the Iblis worms firing the medium-sized ones, and Iblis golems and titans are throwing the big ones. But at the very least, that's still like a different kind of attack. Eggman's robots, a lot of them, it's just missiles and machine guns. You know, some of the missiles might vary in size. You have the small missiles being fired by the likes of the egg gunners and the egg stingers, and then you have the gold egg gunners, which are firing the super big missiles that can hurt you even when you're not touching the explosion. But a lot of them just feel the same. And even if their attacks are different, a lot of them might still look the same. Egg Lancers, while their attacks may be different, or at least one of them, they still have the rapid fire machine guns. But while they may have that weird electrical laser, whatever it is, attack that's incredibly accurate, but with a rather poor range, they still just look like blue egg gunners. And even then, that's not an attack that's unique to them, because some of those flying invisible ones, and that lava looks absolutely horrible, those flying invisible ones that often wipe out the other enemies, they have that same attack, as well as a rapid-fire machine gun. So, I kind of wish that Eggman's robots had a little bit more variety in terms of appearance. Not appearance, in terms of attacks. Because a lot of it is still the same thing. I mean, these guys are different. And it doesn't really matter what they actually have as arms, whether it's them just firing their massive arms, or whether or not their arms are made of those giant metallic balls. Because it's the same attack that they use. By the way, meteors will still fall right there. So it is very possible to get hit by a meteor right before the goal ring. I'm sure that's annoying to many people. Alright, Flame Core actually didn't take that long. I like that. That's pretty good. So if you know where all the keys are, you can probably end that a lot faster. I mean, I know I did die. But generally, that actually wasn't so bad. But now, Radical Train. This is a stage that a lot of people really like to speedrun. If you look at it on YouTube, quite a lot of people actually like to utilize a glitch that I can never pull off, where it's something about you, if you're in flying mode, you continually pause the game, and if you can pause it and unpause it at just the right spot as Rouge is about to hit the ground, and it works with Knuckles as well, they will go launching into the air, and you can actually use that to skip a good chunk of the level. And that's something that a lot of people like to do. Unlike me, however, I'm no good at pulling that sort of stuff off. So, I am going to do this the legitimate way and actually race against the train. After all, that is the gimmick of the stage. So I may as well go with the gimmick. I'm not entirely sure if you're still racing against the train when you control Rouge, though. Because have a Rouge section where you have to wipe out all the enemies to proceed with no ground beneath you. Oh, who's left? Who's left? Ah, damn it. I even hit the switch. Right. Managed to do that a lot faster this time. Yeah, you're still racing against the train, so you still got to make sure you go through it pretty quickly. And remember, hit those dash pads right in the middle, otherwise you will get launched off the edge. Now this is where things become a little bit strange. And I think that line is a little bit delayed there, Rouge. Why do we need this spring? And that looks really painful. In fact, it looks painful in a Sonic's Max Speed section. This just launches Rouge headfirst into the ground. Now, I'm not sure if you're still going against the train here, so I would recommend that you still do this pretty quickly. And yes, we're standing on chimneys with no ground, but we're somehow still able to stand here. This is the kind of level design that I absolutely hate with Knuckles and Rouge. You need to wipe out all of these enemies in order to proceed, where it will just randomly make the actual ground itself appear. You can still climb the chimneys, but you have enemies that can fire a hell of a lot of missiles at you, and rapid fire machine guns. And yeah, you do it to make actual level design appear. Not just a set of springs or anything like that, you know, you need it for actual level design. Which I find to be really odd, right? Yeah, that's just it. I don't know the words for it. It's such a strange thing to make appear. Just to make the level design itself just appear in front of you. Thankfully, the keys, it's either you or the keys, have rather large hitboxes. Adventure 2 did that as well. You didn't exactly have to touch the Master Emerald pieces in order to pick it up. Unless you were digging. Then it was always quite picky. Which really makes me glad that they added that magnifying glass in. Not magnifying glass. There's no magnifying glass. It really makes me glad that they added in that exclamation mark whenever you were close to a Master Emerald piece. Because you didn't have that in the Dreamcast version, so if you were trying to. If you had to dig to find an Emerald piece. Oh yeah. Where am I going? Really, Rouge? You can't grab a hold of these walls? Okay. Why Rouge is so selective about walls is something that I really don't understand. She really couldn't grab a hold of those walls. Now, you gotta be quick here. They want you to take out a lot of enemies, so be quick. Because this is gonna be a tight one. So take them all out as fast as you possibly can. I mean, if you're able to utilize that thing where Shadow's aerial attacks are somehow capable of taking out an enemy where he's not even close to, good. Because that can be really beneficial there. I don't get what causes that, but if it is something that you yourself can utilize, then great. Because it will be very helpful. I was just about to say, there's got to be more than just that one egg stinger, surely. Oh, we're going to do it this way, are we? kind of design is that? Because how are you going to know whether or not Shadow is actually going to clip through the... How are you supposed to know if Shadow is actually going to clip through the case? That's stupid design. No, I can't control when Shadow is going to go into it. There we go. They didn't even tell you that you can do that. That would be by pure luck that you discover you can do that. That's what happened to me. Because it's happened to me a few times in Radical Train. I've activated Shadow's Chaos Powers and I've accidentally clipped through the case. But generally, that was usually after defeating the last enemy, where the case's hitbox was starting to disappear anyway. So, you know, that's twice now that we've come across something like that. And no, I don't think that's very good design at all, because there's nothing telling you that you can do that. At the very least, give us some context that that's what we can do. I mean, granted, when you see... if you are doing them in order, or if you do one before the other, whether it's this stage or Kingdom Valley, you'll probably get the idea that you will have to do that, but at first you won't. I mean, you'll probably get the idea eventually, but there's nothing telling you that you can do that. And no, I didn't think that's very good design. At least allow you, give you a way that you, that the game can tell you you can do that. Although, don't worry about Eggman. He is actually waiting for us. His train is lying completely still. He is very patiently waiting for us, even though Shadow is technically already there. I'm guessing the warp hole sends him there, but they decided Omega's here in the middle, so let's have them play as him first. But Shadow is just waiting beside Eggman's train for Omega to get there. And see, it's right there. Not until you hit that dash pad. And this is where Shadow's stage would normally go into the second part. And now the train starts moving. Now you can just proceed with everything as normal. By the way, it is very possible for the spike to take damage in the air, which is also incredibly stupid. Okay. Thankfully, there's another bike here. So, catch up to that train as fast as you can. If the boost works, that's great. If it doesn't work, you have an issue. Of course, the boost always just seems to work when it wants to. Come on! Ammo! There we go. Right. Well. The middle of that stage is rather questionable, but amazingly we actually got an S rank for it. I think I'm beginning to see why many people like to speedrun Rouge's section by using that glitch. Why can't she climb up the walls? That's so stupid. The walls look exactly like how they did in Dry Lagoon, so why can't she climb up them there? It looks like Dry Lagoon to me, so I don't know why she can't climb up the walls in Radical Train. So somehow she's capable of climbing up an incredibly, well, from the looks of it, a rather smooth chimney wall, but climbing up a cliff that will have all sorts of areas for you to grab onto is completely and utterly impossible. That's just stupid. So apparently it's selective on exactly where Rouge can grab a hold of the wall. I mean, I already find Rouge being able to grab a hold of the wall to be pretty stupid. I want to know how she does it. Because with Knuckles at the very least, well, I do question how he's doing it with his feet. He has those spikes on his knuckles that give him his name. And that's how he climbs the walls, and I guess he's able to then get himself into a position where he can get his feet on the wall, and that's how he climbs up. But how does Rouge do it? Because ever since Adventure 2, it just looks like she climbs the walls, but it's never really explained how she climbs the walls. And it looks like in this stage as well, we're also going to be fighting Eggman's robots. I'm just going to assume we do it for every stage. Take out these guys. I'm not sure which one of those damaged me? Was it this guy's attack or was it the Egg Stinger's missile? I wish to know, because they both hit me at pretty much the exact same time. But how does Rouge climb the walls? I mean, Knuckles in this game is still pulling into his inner Spider-Man, because he's clearly not actually got his knuckles into the wall. He's just got like really sticky gloves. It's like Rouge does the same thing, but Rouge, I've always wondered, how does she climb the walls in Adventure 2? So again, with Knuckles, you can see he's using his knuckles, but how is Rouge doing? And Rouge is a bat. Okay, that makes sense that she can fly, but how does she climb up the walls and everything? I've never seen a bat do that. I mean, bats don't even have their own set of actual arms. Now, Rouge is a very weird bat. She's a bat with a human body, basically. You know, besides the bat wings and the bat head, that's pretty much the human body she's got there. I mean, a bat's hands are within its wings. Whenever you look at a bat's wings, it often looks like it has a load of points on the underside of it. Those are the tips of its fingers. Rouge, however, has a pair of wings and her own set of arms. Her own set of arms. That sounds weird. That makes her sound like an octopus. That's actually something I don't think we've had in the Sonic series yet, an octopus. Or anything aquatic, now I think about it. Well, we've had a robotic fish. But that does make me wonder how many hands does Rouge technically have? Because she has a pair of arms and she has wings, which in most bats are the arms, complete with their finger bones. Yet, because that's clearly what she's got there. That her wings clearly have that. So apparently that thing doesn't work again. Why can't I grab a hold of this? Later on in the stage, if I was playing as Knuckles, he would be able to grab a hold of that. Why can't I grab that there? So if this guy hits you, you're going down regardless. Ugh. Why can't I grab a hold of these walls? Because this place looks just like Security Hall. All these things that look just like stages that we've already been to. Where you'd think you'd be able to do it. Look, they barely give you enough air there. Do you think you'd be able to grab a hold of them? But apparently no. Because these walls just look like a lot like the ones in Security Hall. We can grab every wall in Security Hall. And we grabbed a load of walls before that look just like the ones in Dry Lagoon, so why can't I grab the walls here? Yeah, she's perfectly capable of grabbing hold of the rock sides in Wave Ocean, as the final story will show us. Why is this game so... I mean, I get it. They're designed without Rouge in mind. Because Rouge should never come through here, but the thing is, Knuckles climbs those things in Sonic's story. A very similar looking object. But it's pretty much the same thing. It's where Silver would do his second ball section. That's where we would control Knuckles. And he has those small little islands that are attached to the walls as well. They're the exact same thing, but he is perfectly capable of climbing up them. So I'm guessing that that was only programmed for those ones, and for some reason they didn't program it all in when creating very hard mode. So now Rouge is very selective on what she can actually grab a hold of. Which is stupid. Like, why can't I just climb up the walls? You can climb up everything in the treasure hunting stages in Adventure and Adventure 2. So why can't I do it here? Why didn't they add in the programming for that? Oh, fine. If it's going to destroy my buggy, I'll do it this way. We'll do it the long way. Once again, we have these incredibly pathetic security gates that do nothing but... They have no purpose except to cause slowdown. Only some of them actually close down. Kind of weird. Right, now can I use these? Yes. Eventually. So, we're enjoying E3. And I've not really been paying attention as to what they've actually been showcasing. I do like how they decide to showcase everything off before the event is actually supposed to start. Because last I checked, the event starts on the 14th. At the time of this recording, it's the 13th of June. And yet... I think so far Nintendo is the only one that hasn't shown off anything. The only major one, anyway. Not that I'm exactly expecting much from Nintendo. So, you know, they decided they're not going to show the NX. You know, that new console that's actually what's making me decide between PS4 and NX. I need to know which one. See, we're done with the stage already.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm trying to make my decision here. Damn it, PS4 and Nintendo NX. So I pick the one that's got the likes of Arkham Knight, Ratchet and Clank, Until Dawn, and there were a number of others, but off the top of my head I don't remember what they are. But mostly Arkham Knight. Or do I pick the one that's got The Legend of Zelda, which is on the Wii U anyway, and will undeniably have a Mario game at some point soon after its release? You know? I kind of would like that. I own every mainstream Mario title. And all the ones on the NES. As well as Mario World, Yoshi's Island, Land 2. Both versions of 64, Sunshine, the Galaxy games, 3D games, and every edition of the new series. So it'll kind of ruin the streak. If I end up not having any Mario game on the NX, but at the same time, I need to know that there's some other stuff on the NX besides Mario. Zelda's not enough, considering that the only Zelda game I've beaten is A Link Between Worlds. But anyway, next time, we can finally end Very Hard Mode, but unfortunately, it requires us to go through Dusty Desert, but before that, Wave Ocean. So, I will see you guys next.